Good morning and welcome to worship with us today at Northwood and Norton Park United Methodist Churches. We are so grateful that you have chosen to join us. Both congregations are very warm and friendly and easily ready to celebrate or to bear witness to the goodness of God in their lives. So we hope that you will have the chance to come and worship with us when we reconvene live. But for now, we're grateful for the safety that both congregations are honoring and by letting us have this worship time together this way. This is the fifth Sunday after Epiphany, and we will also be celebrating communion services later in the worship. So let me invite you, either now or as the music begins, to find something to help to celebrate communion. Of course, if you have it, grape juice and bread would be great, but anything that you find that reminds you of the body and blood of Christ that is appropriate to you in your profession, let me just invite you to gather it at some point, and we will celebrate communion again at the end of our service. So one of the habits of our congregations as of late is to spend some time checking in. And we ask ourselves four questions, which you'll see on the screen in front of you. Where have you seen God? Where have you needed God? Where have you been experiencing joy? And for what are you carrying gratitude? Let me invite you now to take a moment, answer those questions as they come to you. And if you have the opportunity, maybe hit pause and share with those that are worshiping with you or even worshiping amongst you if you're on our live stream. And then share with one another the places where you have seen God at work or are needing God maybe for the week ahead. Now I'd like to invite the congregation to share in the responsive call to worship as well as the gathering unison prayer. You'll see it on the screen in front of you. Let me invite you to participate as you can. I'll have help here in the film studio as well. Create in me a clean heart, O God.
And renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence.
And take not your Holy Spirit from me.
O give me the comfort of your help again.
And sustain me with your willing spirit.
Amen. And now we continue with our gathering unison prayer. O Lord, our heavenly parent, almighty and everlasting God, you have brought us safely to the beginning of this day. Defend us by your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin nor run into any danger, and that, guided by your Spirit, we may do what is righteous in your sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
We now come to the time in our worship where we have our kingdom time, and that is the worship that is very specially oriented to interact with our youth and our children. In the past, we've been using stuffed animals, so if you have a stuffed animal that's with you, I invite you to type into the comments who you have with you and maybe tell us a little bit about it. I today did not bring a stuffed animal, nor did I bring a real animal. Instead, I wanted to talk about a different animal, and it's not one that I can bring in live. I want to talk about a fish, or actually what I really want to do is talk about fishing. Now, how many of you who are watching this today have been fishing? All right. Maybe some of you have even been fishing this year and this season. I have not been ice fishing. Maybe that's something I'll experience at some point in my life, but I haven't done it yet. But I have seen people putting up both their kind of tents and also putting out their ice houses and knowing that people are doing their fishing on the different lakes around here. I have, however, been fishing, and I've been fishing many times, and my first fish that I ever caught was on the Great Lakes. And it was with my grandfather off of Christian Island in Canada, and we were fishing, and I caught a sucker fish. Now, Grandpa was still thrilled that I caught a fish, and obviously we didn't eat it. It wasn't a good fish, but he was very excited for me that I caught one, and he encouraged me to keep trying to get better at fishing so that I could catch other fish and feel successful at it. Now, here's the thing that I've learned, and maybe you've learned this too. How many fish can you catch if you don't put a hook or a net in the water? Any of you know? Someone in my room right now is telling me there's zero. You can't catch any. That's right. If you don't try to fish, you won't catch any. Now, if I try to fish, I might catch some, I might not, I might catch fish I didn't want, but I can always throw them back. The thing is, if you don't try, you can't succeed. Today, we're going to talk a little bit what happens when Jesus comes into the room where they've been trying to fish and haven't succeeded, and what happens when Jesus adds to the fishing story. I will tell you that things get surprising. So, my prayer for you and for all who are watching today is that first off, you have opportunities to fish and hopefully with people that you love. And then secondly, to remember the things that you learn when fishing are true in life, especially when it comes to catching fish or getting things done. If you don't try, you will never succeed. So here's hoping that you'll have some opportunities to go fishing and have some success at it too. Will you join with me in a prayer? We invite you to put your hands together any way you want. And you can have your eyes open or closed, but just repeat after me if you would. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for creating us.
Thank you for creating us.
Thank you for fish.
Thank you for fish.
And people to fish with.
And people to fish with.
Help us find joy.
Help us find joy.
In fishing.
In fishing.
And sharing.
And sharing.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you so much for coming to Kingdom Time. And I hope you'll enjoy the rest of our service, the music, and the stories that we tell about Jesus. Today we have two scriptures, as we typically do. One is coming from the book of Isaiah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8, and the other is from the Gospel of Luke. Let me read Isaiah first. It reads, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.' The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, 'Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.' Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it, and with it said, 'Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out.' Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send and who will go for us?' And I said, 'Here am I, send me.'" Our second reading is coming from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. "Once, while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out on them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, 'Put out into the deep water and let your nets out for a catch.' Simon answered, 'Master, we have worked all night long, but have caught nothing. Yet, if you say so, I will let down the nets.' When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees saying, 'Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man.' For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, 'Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people.' When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him." May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of these words. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Sermon for both congregations. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts find acceptance before you and your Spirit. Amen. So I really love the privilege of reading this passage from Luke today, because we live in a unique place to hear this type of scripture. I've lived near some lakes growing up, one's called Boone Lake, Watauga Lake, Fort Patrick Henry. But outside of the Outer Banks of North Carolina, rarely have I read scripture that we can almost imagine happening in our own area. There are a lot of places people fish, but very few places where they still use nets. But some parts of Lake Superior, they do still use box nets. And so that's unique to us in that respect. In the same way, Luke's story of Jesus calling the first disciple is unique among the Gospels. While Mark and Matthew speak of Jesus walking along the Sea of Galilee and abruptly calling Simon, Andrew, James, and John to follow him, only Luke tells the story of a miraculous catch of fish before the call. Now, there are some similarities with the Gospel of John, which is unusual too. As in John, we see a futile night of fishing, then Jesus offering some unsolicited fishing advice, because that's always what people like to hear, followed by an overwhelming catch of fish, and finally, a recognition of Jesus' identity, focusing especially on Simon Peter's response. Now, in Luke's gospel, this is not Simon's first encounter with Jesus, because Jesus has been to Simon's home in Capernaum and healed his mother-in-law. So maybe that explains some of Simon's willingness to let Jesus use the fishing boat as a floating pulpit. What we do know is that Simon had been fishing all night unsuccessfully, and then in the morning hours, early morning hours, he is working with the crew to clean the nets. I would think they would be exhausted and looking forward to getting home and getting some much well-earned sleep. So it must have seemed presumptuous when Jesus got into Simon's boat and asked to put out a little way from shore. But, and this is noteworthy, Simon did what was asked of him. Luke doesn't tell us what Jesus taught anyone. Instead, the focus is upon Jesus' interaction with what comes next. He tells Simon to put out into the deep water, and we probably can identify again here at Lake Superior, what would it mean to go away from the shore and get into the deep water? And there is where you let down your nets for a catch. Now, Simon, for a couple reasons, thinks that this is a futile exercise. He is a professional fisherman. And we can almost hear the exasperation in the tone of voice that he uses, saying, "Master, you know, we've worked all night and caught nothing." But I love that he says, I will do what you've asked. So we know what happens next, right? Nets so full of fish, they begin to break. Boats so full of fish, they begin to sink. And seeing what happened is happening, Simon is overwhelmed with fear and wonder, sensing he is in the presence of divine power. And in this way, he resembles the prophet in Isaiah when he says, "Lord, go away from me. I am not appropriate for this space. I am a sinful man." Simon is caught by surprise. In the midst of his ordinary daily grind, and in fact, in a night after a particularly lousy night of work, he is encountering someone who changes everything. He's amazed by the power displayed in the abundant catch of fish, but he's also immediately aware of his sinfulness and unworthiness. He sees the overwhelming difference between God's power manifest in Jesus and then his own, what now looks like a compromised life. But Jesus's response is, "Don't be afraid." And he's not really saying, "Don't be afraid of me." He's saying, "Don't be afraid of who you are. From now on, you're going to catch people. Don't apologize for who you are, Simon. I've got some bigger fish for you to fry." So here Jesus calls Simon and his partners to a new vocation of catching people so they might live a life-giving vocation of being caught up in God's mission of salvation and freedom for all. So what I find very interesting is they have just caught the greatest catch they've ever had in their fishing careers. And yet Simon, Peter, James, John, among others, leave these boatloads of fish and follow Jesus. This encounter with the divine, with Jesus, has transformed them. The text offers so many possibilities of how God might call ordinary people into doing extraordinary things. After all, there's nothing the slightest bit extraordinary about Simon Peter and his fishing partners. I mean, they're fishermen, simple fishermen, and they did what they do every day. They're minding their own business, cleaning their nets after a tough night of work. And then Jesus comes and changes everything from mundane to miraculous. Jesus calls them not as they wish they were, too. He calls them as they are. They're already in their patterns of life. They're in the things that they do all the time. Simon seems acutely aware of his unworthiness, but Jesus isn't put off in the slightest. Recently, I went looking for the best burger I could find in Duluth, and I went to a place called the Anchor Bar with a friend. And my friend said, "This is probably where the salt of the earth gather." Now, along with one of the greater burgers that I've had in the area, because they were right. I did find an incredible swath of behavior, and I wonder if Jesus had walked in there, would we all have felt comfortable? The thing is, I do believe that Jesus walks into these places and accepts everyone who's there, masked or unmasked, washed or unwashed, full of burger or not, and says, "I love you, I receive you, will you follow me?" So Jesus didn't ask Simon and the disciples to get their act together or to get a resume together and then to come back for an interview. Rather, Jesus sees him where he is, sitting right there at the Anchor Bar, tells him, "Don't be afraid," and says, "I now have a new job for you." Throughout Scripture, not just today in this part, but all places, we see Human sin, failure, and inadequacies are not obstacles to God's call. God constantly calls people who see themselves as inadequate to do God's work. People who are aware of their own unworthiness and might be doubting and resistant to God's call. God doesn't wait for us to shape up. God calls us as we are and then works on shaping us into faithful servants. I have to admit that for the last couple weeks, I myself have felt very unworthy to be in front of a camera. Not that I'm any one great picture or a sight of beauty, but not having one's front teeth really can make you feel embarrassed, to say the least, as well as challenge pronunciation and the way that we hear ourselves or feel like we're speaking to others. But all of my resistance to wanting to do this and being available, God said, you need to get over it. And the place where I got over it, by the way, was working with our kids for Jesus FaceTime. It wasn't exactly what I thought I'd need as my transformative moment, but I found that when the kids received me and who I really want to be for Christ, it was my chance to get over the hump and say, I can do this again. I wonder how often we resist Jesus' claim in our lives because what he is calling us to do seems like it's too much for us, that we're not ready. Maybe it's too crazy or too impractical for what we're have prepared for. How do we avoid putting out into the deep waters in following and being bearing witness to Jesus because we're convinced we're not going to see anything happen? What might it mean for us to go deep sea fishing with Jesus, to trust and follow him way outside our comfort zones, to let go of our certainties, to have our lives reoriented? I know, and I realize this, and I want to say this clearly, for most of us, this does not mean leaving our current professions, although it may mean that for some. We are all called by the virtue of our claim through baptism and being part of God's ministry to participate in God's mission to the entire world through Jesus Christ. We are called daily to reorient our priorities to align with God's priorities, to use these gifts that God has given us in service to others, to share the good news of Christ in word and deed. Jesus' mission does not wait until we are ready. The need for the gospel in this broken world is far too urgent. We are called right now, not in spite of our frailty, failures, and doubts, but maybe because of some of them. That even though we have ordinary, busy, complicated lives, Jesus says, you are available to me, and now I want you to learn how to fish for others. Jesus' first word to Simon Peter was, do not be afraid. He says the same to us now. This is the mission, and we trust he will keep working in us and through us, catching others as we have been caught, and the deep, wide net of God's mercy and love. And finally, let me offer you this. Let's enjoy the trust that the catch is in God's hands, and God's desires is for the nets to be bursting and the boats to be full. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Of God, you. keeps you, protects you, and loves you too.
We've come to the time in our worship where we get to celebrate the Great Thanksgiving. Again, if you have communion elements that you would like to use for today, you're more than welcome. We have adapted so many times to bread being small wafers or full loaves with yeast. And our fruit of the vine has been grape juice and wine and everything in between. So whatever it is that you would want to remember Christ and feel his presence, let me invite you to gather those elements together. Now, let us share together in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, and it's good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth, or you had formed the earth, from everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You brought light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When the snow and the ice left this area and you left the great lakes behind, you had in your own mind the idea that people would come and settle here and draw fish from the sea and taste and know that God had blessed them. There are times, though, where we have turned away, where our own love failed, but your love remained steadfast. You are the one who has delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our only God, and you have spoken to us time and time again through your prophets. And so it is today, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join the unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. We remember the times where he lit out on a boat to teach and tell those who had come to listen that you had come to save your people. And then, by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and then shared it with his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took a cup, gave thanks to you, shared it with his disciples, and said again, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so today, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Holy God, pour out your Holy Spirit on each of us gathered to hear these words, and on the gifts that we have gathered of bread and fruit of the vine. May they now for us be the very body and blood of Christ, that in receiving them, we in turn may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by God's grace. Now, by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with one another, and one in ministry to all the world, until you come in final victory and we feast at a heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Let us prepare to share the gifts that God has so richly shared with us, with one another in the presence of the church and into the ministry of the world surrounding us. You'll see in front of you the addresses of where we mail our offerings. And let me say thank you from both congregations for your fidelity and support in helping share your work to let the ministry of these churches thrive in our communities.
Praise God from above.
We come to a time of prayer in our congregations and in our worship. And let me invite you now to consider the different prayers that are on your heart. If you're willing, go ahead and type them into the comments below or share them with the people who are near you. Or if you're willing, please let me know of whatever prayers you might be carrying. I'm thankful for the prayers that were shared with me last week and hope that some of you might still text them to me this coming week as well. The number you would text them to is my number, 828-434-6995. Again, text it to 828-434-6995. Thank you so much. Do know that your prayers are received and that we continue to lift them up and hold you in prayer as well. Let us go together to the Lord. Holy God, we thank you for the privilege of coming before you to speak with you and share with you into your immenseness the things that are a part of our lives. We too are like the prophets who are overwhelmed in coming into your holiness, realizing that we ourselves are not holy, that we've observed or touched or been a part of things that just don't feel right, that we don't feel clean enough or ready enough to be in your presence. Yet you have drawn us close, touched us with hands of Christ, the hands that were bruised on our behalf, and said, I receive you, child. I ask you to be present. Thank you for this gift and help us to receive it. Into you then we pour the various troubles that we have, the ways that our own boats don't seem to make the grade. Too much of some things and not enough of others. Places where we're exhausted and tired and sick. And there are those that we know are in challenging ways. Lord, hear us and respond with love. We pray that we might even be able to see the handiworks that you do, the signs of your movement and the miracles that you offer us, whether they be everyday or supernatural. And Lord, we would ask that you continue to draw forth from us the opportunities to share your gospel, to share your love and remind others that they are received and loved and known. Lord, we may not always get it right, but help us continue to come back and meet with you and to aspire to follow as best we can. We ask this in the name of the one who taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I want to thank everyone for being with us for worship today and for being a part of the lives of these wonderful congregations. We hope to have worship this way one more time in the coming week. And then if there are changes to be made, they'll happen then. So we will look to either be meeting in parking lots or to be meeting in person. And we hope that you'll be there with us. Thank you again for all the ways that you come and your own presence allows our congregations to reach out in love. May God continue to bless you in the week that is, and may you feel God's presence. Go forth from here seeking to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your strength, your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. May we go forth to do so. Amen. Red leather, yellow leather, red leather, yellow leather, red leather, yellow leather, lever. I believe it, that's all, folks.